unfortunately, we're out of what I would call the triage phase or crisis mode. And we're moving into what I believe is our second phase, which is learning really how to operate in what everybody's calling the new normal. Look, the while states are starting to change restrictions and people are starting to go back to work, most of our firms have continued to work. Most all of them are essential businesses in their respective states, but they've been kind of holding their breath, so to speak, hoping that this thing would last 6 to 8 weeks and then we'd come out of it and we'd be normal. I think everybody's recognized that that's not really going to be the case. And so I think firms now are really focused on what does this look for, like for us? What's the impact going to be to our business as we live and operate in this new normal? And I think it's going to mean a lot for CPA firms.
How should CPA firms be responding right now?
Well, communication is still critical. I've gotten a lot of questions and calls about how frequently you should be communicating. And my answer is always the same, which is it depends on what's going on in the marketplace. You know, in the first few weeks of the president issuing the national disaster order, you know, March 13th is sort of the date that we're using, right, of change, of effective change. And those first few weeks, daily, sometimes multiple times a day, communications were critical, right? So much is changing and still is, but it's not changing as quickly as it was before. And so I would say that you need to be communicating as it's relevant to the changes that are happening in the marketplace. As additional guidance comes out, as changes happen from the Treasury or the SBA or the IRS or, you know, something from the AICPA, as things are extended or deferred or delayed, those are important. Do you have to get them out within hours right now? Some firms are still doing that, but I've seen most firms, it's sort of a rule within, you know, 2 to 3 days that we're getting those communications out to the marketplace. I think firms need to be reinforcing the communications that were coming out previously, because there are still so many clients that have a ridiculous amount of questions. And I know that because the work that we're doing and the response that we're getting from various forms of thought leadership that our firms are putting out there is huge. So that tells me that clients still have a lot of unanswered questions. They're still confused about it. You know, my husband, who is in finance, you know, was misquoting, you know, some of the PPP stuff and the loan terms. And he's a very smart, intelligent person. But, you know, that just shows you that it takes a while for all of this to sink in. And not all the information out in the marketplace is the accurate information. And so the other thing that we've been telling our clients is, there's a fear sometimes of putting stuff out there because it's already there. Well, somebody else has already communicated about that. Let me tell you, the people that your clients should be relying on is you. You are the experts in this area. You're the ones that are most knowledgeable. While we don't have all the answers right now related to what's going on, and there is so much change. I mean, in some cases, we've watched the SBA change guidelines, you know, 3 times in 4 or 5 hours and republish that and change applications literally at midnight. You're still the best source of that information. And Facebook, from unreliable sources or unverified sources, isn't accurate. Even some of the biggest publications, and I don't want to pick on them because they're really good, but some of the people writing this content, the source of their information might be coming out of a senator's mouth and not off the bill. It might not be coming from the IRS. They might not be aware of, you know, other things that impact this. And so there's nothing wrong with that. It's just not fully accurate information in all cases. Sometimes it is, and sometimes it's not. We've seen plenty of misquotes around some of the information that's in the marketplace around this. And so it's really critical that firms are communicating to their clients and to the marketplace right now about what's going on, and re-communicating about it once isn't going to be enough for a lot of this stuff.
I was shocked when a tweet became IRS code when Secretary Mnuchin announced the tax deadline was going to be extended to July 15th. And everybody wanted to know on tax Twitter whether that was official or not. I think it took the IRS about 24 hours to put it up on IRS.gov. So apparently it's IRS code and reg now if Mnuchin tweets it.
Yeah, I feel like there's a lot of that going on, right? The president or a senator or Congress, somebody will say something, and then all of a sudden that's, you know, the media sensationalizes it like they do. That's part of, you know, part of what they do right now. And some of it's accurate, and I think some of it's creating some pressure that is good for some of our governing bodies. But we also know that the IRS doesn't typically move very fast to publish things. And so, but that's the whole reason that firms need to be communicating, because they end up getting a lot of calls, or all of a sudden the clients think that they don't have to do something, and then they're getting a call from their CPA and they're really confused. And so that's why this communication piece is so critical right now for CPA firms. And we're still seeing plenty of firms that have not put anything on their websites, aren't sending emails. They're like, well, we talk to all our clients. I'm like, that's great, but you can't talk to every client. You know, if you've got a thousand tax clients, and that's just on a conservative end for, you know, a smaller firm, you're not going to be able to call every single one of those clients. And, you know, if they're not getting information from you, they're absolutely getting information from your competitors, or could be.
How are CPA firms weathering this storm?
There's going to be a deferment of cash, right? There's going to be a cash flow crunch for a lot of firms. And I would say that by and large, most of the firms I've talked to have applied for the PPP loan. Most of them have received it, right? I'd be shocked if that wasn't the case, you know, other than, you know, the cobbler's kids rule. But hopefully, I think that most firms applied for that, and as they should, to be able to address this. What I'm still trying to validate, and what I don't have concrete data on yet, is I'm getting the sense that they don't feel like this is going to impact their growth overall. And usually those would be very contradictory statements, where in a survey we dig into that and we go, something's not right, like you're answering one question this way. But in this environment, I think it's very accurate, right? I think they think they're going to potentially grow. They have the ability, I think, to invoice their clients for new services, a lot of which they're doing right now about the PPP loan and some other areas, depending on the specialties of the firm. So I think that overall, they think their gross growth numbers, if you're looking at what am I selling, right, what am I billing, it's just a matter of collecting on some of that. And that, by and large, seems to be a running theme across most size firms. I do believe that firms that are a little bit smaller right now are much more nimble and being able to bring some new things to market. They're also not struggling with what we're seeing at the top end of the marketplace right now, which is firms having to face layoffs and furloughs. And we're seeing more and more data about all of that starting to come through for a lot of the larger firms. Most of our mid-sized firms and smaller firms are not having to address that. And they've, because they're smaller, they've got a lot more flexibility and what they're doing. And so I feel like a lot of those firms are going to have or will have a lot of opportunity if they take advantage of it. And that's more around mindset and making the time and barreling through creating something that they may have maybe haven't done before, doing something differently than they had done previously.
So we're moving from a compliance season and a compliance business model to all of a sudden an advisory season and an advisory business model.
And that's absolutely accurate. I couldn't agree more with that. We hear so much about that. I feel like some people are sort of deaf. They're tired of hearing compliance to advisory, but it's accurate. And, you know, another hypothesis that I have that we're trying to sort of validate through the survey, and we may or may not be able to do, is it seems to me from an outsider, and the firms that we work with that have had strong advisory practices already are having an easier time adapting. They're also more willing to charge for their services because they've overcome that hurdle of clearly identifying what is advisory, what isn't advisory. You know, there's some firms that are still hesitant to charge for some of these services around the PPP loans. And the AICPA has given plenty of guidance and a lot of good guidance around clarity. They just issued something, I think earlier this week or the end of last week, on, you know, tied to engagement letters and kind of clearly defining the different roles that you can play in some of this. But I still talk to firms and they're like, oh, we can't charge our clients for this. Yes, you can. Why would you give your expertise away for free? And it doesn't mean you're going to get paid right away. And it doesn't mean that you don't work with them on a payment schedule, but why would you not charge? You're providing a significant amount of value for them, and you can't be afraid to indicate that. This is the thing that they want most right now. The thing that people want, they're willing to find money for. I'm sorry, if you can go online shop to Amazon and every place else while you're in COVID and buy some of the ridiculous things, you can spend a few $100 with your CPA firm to get the advice you need to hopefully help your business sustain some of this. And more, if you're doing the right things for your clients, you're ideally focusing on how they create cash, or conserve their cash, or adjust their business so that they can stay afloat. And that's valuable. Without you, they might fold and go under.
Tell me more about what this new normal is going to look like.
Well, I don't have a crystal ball on what the new normal looks like, but what it feels like to me is that we all are coming to the conclusion that we realize we're going to be living with COVID for quite a long time. I don't know if anybody knows how long that is. I think when we entered this crisis, we thought it was going to be short term. I know I did. I don't think I'm different than the rest of the population. I think I was overly hopeful that we'll get through our stay at home, we would flatten the curve, and we'd go back to normal, and this thing would be gone, and we'd be good. It'd be like the end of flu season, and we're done. And maybe that's a bad analogy, but I feel like everybody kind of went into this thinking that. And then as we went through self-isolation and quarantine in a lot of our states, I think we're realizing that this is something we're going to be living with. And so as we come out of this, I think CPA firms are really trying to figure out what that looks like, right? Tax and audit don't change, right? The services themselves are still needed. How we deliver those services, how we engage with clients, how we build relationships with each other, that's all changing. And that's what I think people are trying to figure out, how to live within that new normal and what it means, because we can't wait until we're back in the office to meet with clients. And I'm hearing that from a number of professionals. Well, I'll meet with my clients about how their business is doing when we're back in the office and I can be face to face. And I'm telling them, like, I don't wait. That could be next year before that is really the case. And trying to figure out how to serve clients. And I think the whole world's had to adapt to technology at a faster pace than some of them wanted to or ever planned on. And these firms that, even were fairly technology advanced, every firm is trying to figure out what this means for them and how they're going to operate as well. And so when we look at living in the new normal, it's impacting every aspect of the business, from communication and relationship building to operations, to even growth. Today, how do we grow our firm amid this environment when you can't go to trade shows, when you can't go to events and do some of the things that we used to do in traditional networking? How do we do all that and gain traction?
I've been impressed by how firms that were saying it would take them 4 to 6 years to go virtual or move to the cloud figured out a way to do it in 4 to 6 days. It's just amazing what they can get done when they absolutely have to.
Yes, I would agree. There's been a lot of commentary about that in the marketplace, but it makes me happy. I feel like the silver lining of this is that the change that needed to happen that actually is going to help the majority of firms in the long run is good. This is going to be a good outcome for the profession. I think that we're going to remove more boundaries, the staffing challenges that were happening before, I think are going to be lessened, because people are going to realize you can have a virtual worker. I was just on the phone with a firm the other day that said we hired our first virtual assistant, and we always thought that we couldn't have an administrator that was virtual, and it's working great. And it's like this big aha moment for a lot of firms, I think. And it's not easy. I think the biggest challenges are things like management and learning how to manage differently. And a lot of the people that really probably never plan to change their management styles are being forced to do that as well. And those are the firms that I think, and people that are struggling a little bit in the virtual environment right now. And virtual isn't the right fit for everybody, but the outcome of that is we probably weren't managing in the best ways that we could have managed before. And this is forcing us to be a little bit better in how we communicate and get the best out of people and focus on the right things, as opposed to management by sight, which is your butt's in a seat, so I assume you're doing what you should be doing. And I can go up and talk to you. And in a virtual environment, you can't do that. You gotta communicate and manage in a totally different way.
It feels as though something big is happening, and it's going to leave a lasting mark on how we live and how we do business. What does that look like to you?
Yeah, again, I don't have a crystal ball on any of this, but what I can tell you is here's what my hope is. I don't believe the core foundation of what CPA firms do, the compliance piece, is going to change. I do believe how they deliver that is going to change. I believe that, and my hope that coming out of this is that firms and clients are much more comfortable using the technology available to complete that work, to eliminate altogether things like exchanging paper, to complete your tax returns. There's no reason. All of the technology is available and has been available for years, and there's some really great technology out there to engage with clients. On the audit side, it's a little bit more challenging, but we know that remote audits have been possible for a long time, and so a lot of firms are trying to really figure that out. There's always a small component of things that are there. I believe that if that is a change that stays the course, that we're going to have to see some guidance and regulation change. So I think that could be coming to be it. But I do think that we're going to see a wide adoption and a huge spike in advisory services, because most firms are going to have to go there to be able to do this. I think that you know, I predict that the CAS services are going to take a huge spike as well. Amid this environment, a lot of people need that type of guidance, not just the bookkeeping, but the controllership and the CFO level guidance as well around some of this. So my hope is that we come out of this growing as a profession. And I think there's the firms that are going to be able to sustain this well. They're taking the mindsets of using this as an opportunity to invest into their future and their growth, albeit amid a lot of change right now, which is never easy to handle. But my other hope is that through all of this, we will also recognize that the billable hour isn't as important as it once was. And I do believe that by managing people virtually, it will recognize that. You know, we're having lots of conversations, you know, productivity is down, but my question back to the profession is work product output down. Are we still getting accomplished what we need to? And that's not as easily measurable for some people right now. But, you know, my hope is that we come out of this and we've seen a much larger adoption of the non-billable hour pricing, whether it's flat fee, value pricing, you know, there's folks out there that are talking about the subscription pricing. I'm still not convinced that that's going to work well for the profession. But, you know, flat fee pricing and value pricing, you know, absolutely. It's a huge opportunity right now. But I think that the firms have to see that from a management standpoint, that the billable hour, you know, doesn't equal the work product and the output deliverable, that the two don't necessarily always go hand in hand. One isn't better than the other. And so once we can recognize that and get our mindset off of the billable hour, I think firms will be able to adapt. And I think we'll see a lot of firms maybe play around with that and test it in this environment, especially as they start offering new services, whether even if it's just starting with flat fee pricing around some of the advisory work that they're doing on the PPP loans and some of the other stuff that's out there right now.
How long will it take for this business to bounce back?
Yes, I think that some firms are just going to close. I think that some of those client bases, sadly, are going to go away amidst this COVID environment, either because they closed and they couldn't operate or because they've got a lot of individuals. And maybe those individuals are in this range of folks that are most susceptible to COVID right now and aren't surviving COVID, which is really sad. But I think that a portion of those client bases are just going to go away. And so I do think that there's opportunity. We're watching firms still hire right now, and it's not the biggest firms. And I'm telling all of our clients, look, you know, this war for talent that you guys have been struggling with, take advantage of it right now. If you can, if you can squeeze and eke something out amidst all of this, don't be afraid to hire someone, because for most of those firms, they only need one or two good people, that manager or, you know, a potential successor. And there's a lot of fear right now for anybody that's working in a larger firm is whether I have a job, is my salary being cut, am I going to be furloughed? So I'm telling firms, use this as an opportunity right now to get in front of those people, because they're definitely going to be much more receptive right now than they might have ever been otherwise. And the advantages of a smaller mid-sized firm right now are fantastic. And I do believe that firms will come out. I don't think anybody is going to be posting double-digit growth this year. I would say the firms that are doing well are probably going to break even, possibly 1 or 2% growth, probably not much more than that. And the firms that are struggling are going to be showing negative. And my hope is that by next year that we see that start to rebound. But I think a lot of that will be dependent on what happens with COVID and how long we have to live with this and what that really looks like. And I don't think any of us know the answer to that right now. I think the final piece of advice that I would leave with is that don't be afraid to act. Don't be afraid to try something. Part of growing means that you're going to have to try something. Sometimes you might fail at it, and sometimes it will succeed wildly beyond your dreams and your imagination. And so if you're a smaller or mid-sized firm, you have the ability to be so nimble right now, and don't lose focus of just reacting. Try to look at what's the opportunity and what should our firm be doing over the course of the next 6 to 9 months that we haven't done before, whether it's to continue to serve our clients, to serve the marketplace, because there are so many opportunities out there that I think firms don't recognize. There's so many clients that are not being served well right now by their CPA firms. And so don't be afraid to try something new. Don't be afraid to put yourself out there. I think you'll probably be surprised at the response that you get.
Sarah Dobek, leader of both Innovatus Consulting and CPA's Net. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rick.